we're going to do today in our second meeting is finish off a little bit of the discussion of finance versus regular capitalist enterprises, what we were doing last week. And after we talk a little bit about that, bringing that to bear on the crisis in the global economic system and here in the United States as well, then we'll turn to the second topic, which is doing an advanced Marxist kind of analysis of a place that might surprise you, namely the household, the modern household, and how Marxian analysis would enter the household and analyze what's going on there. So let's begin by recalling where we left off last time. And I'm going to draw again, just to remind you, a rectangle representing what goes on in your typical capitalist enterprise. And if you remember, this rectangle, which we drew, is the value added by workers when they work. Part of the value added when workers work, for example, if you recall the chair factory, when the chair capitalist buys wood and glue and hammers and nails and pays out money for them, and then hires workers to use the tools that the capitalist has purchased to work on the raw materials that the capitalist has purchased. When the work is done, when the chair is produced, the chair has more value than the ingredients in it, the lumber, the glue, the saws, the nails. The difference in the value of the chair compared to the value of the materials in it is the value added by the laborer when the laborer works. And the question in Marxian theory is, what happens to that value added? We did that last week. Part of it goes back to the worker in the wage. So part of what the worker adds by his or her work is given back to him or her at the end of the week in their wage or their salary. The other part, the part that of value that the worker's labor adds that the worker doesn't get, is the surplus value. It's what accrues to the employer. It's what the employer is in the business to get. What the employer tries to do is to maximize this as a portion of the total value added that the worker produces by his or her labor. We also went over how the capitalist, no sooner has the capitalist appropriated the surplus value, then the capitalist must distribute the surplus value to make sure that all the conditions are in place for the capitalist enterprise to survive, for the capitalist enterprise to grow. Remember, we went through it. Taxes have to be paid to the government so that the government can do all the things that are necessary. Have a police department, have a court system, secure foreign markets for your goods, and so on. We also went through a variety of other expenditures, to managers, to merchants, and so on. But I want to focus us on one, the distribution of a portion of the surplus to the banks. What Marx, in his own writings, calls money-lending capital. That's what banks do, they lend money. And if you're interested in the Marxian theory from the horse's mouth, from Marx's own writings, then what you want to do is you want to go to Capital, his major economic analysis, volume 3, and there are long sections in there called Money Lending Capital. And basically what I'm about to do is apply in a condensed way what Marx works out as his analysis of what we would nowadays call finance capital. He called it then money lending. And you'll see a whole bunch of chapters in volume 3 devoted to that. The argument, simply put, a capitalist needs to be able to access credit. A capitalist cannot be dependent on his or her own accumulated wealth, because at any given time, in the ebb and flow of business, in the competition with others, our capitalist may need a chunk of money. Let me give you some examples. A new machine is invented, very expensive, but that really produces more goods per hour of work than ever were possible before. His competitors are buying that machine, our capitalist has to, but it's very expensive. He doesn't have the money. He can go to a bank and get the money. And that may mean the difference between survival and collapse. Another example. It's taking longer than usual to sell the output. Normally, he can sell so much and he gets the money from selling it, and that money is available to pay his workers. But it's taking a little longer. They'll be sold, but it's taking longer. But the workers aren't going to come to work on Monday if you don't pay them on Friday. So he goes to the bank to borrow money to pay his workers and see him through until the revenue from selling comes in. There are 1,000 other examples of capitalists who need access to capital beyond what they themselves own. Banks provide them. How do banks do it? Banks, which are themselves in historical development, have to go through a long period of time before they're in a position to lend money to an industrialist. For example, you have to convince people to deposit their money in a bank. You may all take it for granted that when you have money, you go get a bank account. That took a long time to get people comfortable to do that. Ditto for companies. You have to trust the banker, you have to believe that this is safe, etc., etc. So banks have to develop, but in modern capitalism, we're going to assume they exist, and now here's the relationship. The banks provide capitalist enterprises, industrial capitalists, those who produce commodities, with an important condition of their survival and growth, namely access to pools of money as and when they need it. That's what banks provide. In exchange, the bank demands a cut of the capitalist surplus. If we're going to give you what you need, you've got to give us a reason to lend that money to you. What's in it for the bank is they're going to get back more money than they lend. The principal plus the interest. What's in it for the industrial capitalist, the commodity producer, to give interest to a bank is it secures the industrial capitalist's access to credit. And that's the relationship. That's a crucial relationship. More today than at any other time, because almost all businesses, and certainly all large businesses, are dependent on their relationships with banks. They must have credit. They must have credit in an ongoing way. The way you can see that is if you go to any large corporation you're familiar with, use Google. Go to the Google, look up the corporation, and look up its basic financial statistics. And there you'll see a number for the outstanding debt, and you'll be amazed at how big it is. Most large corporations have debts in the multiple millions or billions of dollars. Most of the corporations you know are constantly rolling over this debt, paying back a debt and taking out another one because they couldn't go on without it. They must have that. Okay, so the bank makes the interest as its income. The capitalist pays a cut of the surplus he gets from his workers to the banks for access to credit. That would be a simple story, and that's part of what Marx teaches in Volume 3 of Capital. But life is always more complicated than the first part of the story. So it turns out banks don't only lend to industrial capitalists. If they did, what I just told you would be about the end of the story. But the story gets complicated. Banks, who collect all the deposits of society, all the liquid money that individuals, businesses, and so on have, may find themselves, and often have, taking in more money than the industrial capitalists are interested in borrowing. That's then a problem. Why? Because the bank, when it takes in the money, has expenses. It has to have that big vault. It has to have the security guard you notice standing there doing nothing all day except earning his pay. They need to have people keep records of how much money you put in and how much. They have to have those people make your monthly statement that they mail you in the mail, and they have to pay the postage. They have expenses. They recoup these expenses by charging interest on their loans. Therefore, they're in great trouble if the money flowing into the banks as deposits and so forth cannot be relent by the bank at interest. So imagine a bank collecting deposits, which they're always trying to do, but discovering that the industrial capitalists are not borrowing anywhere near enough for the bank to survive. The bank would then have to go and, ready, find other borrowers, or else risk death, economic death. So they do. The banks lend to governments. Very popular. The banks take the deposit and they lend it to the government. Their own government? Well, other governments too. Any government where they can get a good rate of interest and feel secure that they'll get that money back. They'll get repaid. But they can also lend, and they often do, to workers. That's an interesting idea. You could take the deposit and lend it to a worker. Two examples. I'll give you three. Four examples. One, you could lend it to workers to buy homes, individual homes. Of course, that only works in a society where workers are not all renters, which they have been and are in many societies, because workers don't have the money to do anything else but rent. But now workers could be offered a loan to buy a house, using the house as the collateral for the loan that allows them to buy the house. That's called mortgage finance. So banks will lend to workers with the collateral of a house. But banks will lend to workers for other things. Over 90% of all automobiles sold in the United States are sold on credit. Those of you who've had the experience, you go into a dealer, you pick out a new or used car, and then you sit in another office working out the credit arrangement. You're going to work out paying so much a month for 3, 4, 5 years. That paperwork you do, that's actually a loan that a bank is giving you. The bank isn't there because they trust the car dealer to act as the agent of the bank. But if you actually read those documents, which fortunately most Americans never do, you'd learn that you are taking out a loan to buy that car. What's basically happening is the bank pays the car company for the full value of the car you're buying. And you have to pay back the bank for the money it gave the car dealer when you bought. The car dealer has nothing to do with this anymore. You are now in debt to the bank. And wherever you mail your payment, it's to the bank that it goes. So that's a very profitable deal. Banks like that. They lend to workers for their homes, they lend to workers for their cars. Third, they lend to workers for daily expenditures. That's called a credit card. Workers take out a credit card. When you use the credit card, when that piece of plastic slides through the little scanner, what's happening there, if you look at the paperwork, you'd see it, is the following. You, let's say you're buying a $100 pair of pants. When you slide the card, what's actually happening is a bank, the name of the bank on your card, a bank is sending the $100 into the account of the store where you're buying the pants. And it's charging you as now having a debt to the bank of the $100 that you just borrowed to buy the pants. You don't, it's not explained to you that way, but that's what it is. A credit card is a system for workers or anyone who owns the card to borrow money from a bank. That's why it's issued by a bank. Yeah?
Isn't there a fee system too?
Yes, the way credit cards, it's a real boondoggle. Credit cards work as follows. The merchant agrees to pay a fee. Usually it's around 2%, sometimes as much as 5 and 6%. But basically I think it's around 2%, 3%. So actually out of the $100 pants you're buying, the storekeeper doesn't get 100. The storekeeper gets, say, $98 or $97. But you have a debt of 100 to the bank. So that's how the bank is now making money off of the merchant. And why would the merchant do that? Because the merchant wants the customers who wouldn't otherwise come in there unless they could use their credit card. So the merchant pays a fee to the bank. By the way, this is money out of the pocket of the merchant. How does the merchant recoup that? By charging higher prices. So the person who shops in a store who doesn't use a credit card is subsidizing the people who do, paying higher prices because the merchant has to give a fee to the bank, in case you didn't understand that before. So that's a big source of bank loans to workers. The fourth one, student loans. becoming very important in the United States. Americans can no longer afford college. It's basically a reality. And so students are more and more having to borrow to go to school. So this becomes another way to lend to the masses. And finally, although I don't have the time to go through it with you, banks lend to each other. Very important business. Banks are forever needing more money, and they can't get more deposits, but they want to make money lending out money. They borrow from each other. It's an enormous operation. You're aware of it, involving trillions of dollars almost every day, money moving among banks. Okay? So now we get what? Banks are constantly weighing the pros and cons of lending money to industrial capitalists, that's where we started the story, versus lending to governments, lending to workers, and lending to each other. The job of the banker is to weigh the returns you get from each of these different kinds of loans against the risks involved in lending them. Under certain historical circumstances, it may become much more profitable to a bank, higher interest, lower risk, not to lend to an industrial capitalist, but rather to lend to one of them. So let me give you an example from American history. Starting in the 1970s, the long period in the United States of rising real wages for workers came to an end. There's been no basic rise in the real wage of the American working class for 30 years. This was a trauma to American workers, and so one of the responses of the American working class, starting in the 1970s, to keep their consumption rising, as they had become used to for over 100 years, was to borrow money. But it was a desperate working class. The only way to deliver the American dream to yourself and your children, since you didn't get any more wages, was to borrow. And so Americans who had grown up for 100 years with the proud virtue of not borrowing, celebrated by their grandparents and their parents and the minister in the church and everybody else, suddenly had to be transformed as a population into people willing to take on not just some debt, but huge amounts of debt. At first, use credit card only for an emergency. Then you use credit card for your big purchases. And nowadays, as many of you realize, you use your credit card to buy a bag of potato chips for your groceries. That all took time to convince Americans to do that. But they were desperate. And so not only did the Americans were desperate to borrow, but because they were desperate, because there was no other way to keep the consumption going, rising, to pay for the modern conveniences of life in the last 30 years, here we come down, the punchline. Banks were able to get from consumers a rate of return compared with risk that made it more profitable for a bank to lend to workers than to capitalists, or to governments, or to one another. And suddenly, banks developed huge departments of what was called consumer lending. We never had that before. We never had that before because it was profitable. You know it here in New York because you cannot walk more than two blocks in any direction anywhere in New York City without seeing a bank on the corner. They're sustaining the office real estate market in New York City. And imagine if that situation changes, you're going to see empty storefronts where now you see Chase or any one of the 100 other banks that are staring at you every 5 minutes. It's profitable. And they therefore will lend. And they begin to realize, wow, we can get a rate of return from workers we couldn't dream of from a capitalist. Commercial loan to a capitalist these days pays, oh, 3, 4, 5%. Credit card loan to a worker these days, 19%. It's not very difficult. Not very difficult a choice. But now watch the craziness of capitalism as Marx teaches it. If banks lend to workers because it's more profitable, they may say to capitalists, we don't have money for you. Or they may charge them enough higher interest because unless those capitalists pay more, they'd rather lend it to workers. This could mean that capitalists get shut off from a kind of credit they need to function. So the capitalist, doing what the job of the capitalist is, to make the maximum profit with the credit, with the money, could actually kill the economic system out of which the banks themselves grew. They could stifle the credit being lent to business. Let's give you an example of when that happened in history. Here's the example. Now! Right now! All across America, if you check with businesses, they will tell you, we can't get loans, we can't get loans, the bank won't lend to us. It just won't lend to us, the terms are too onerous. Wow, what's that about? That's because banks have either other more preferred outlets for their lending, or you could have another problem. And this problem is also today. The banks got so into lending to workers, they were making such profits that they overdid it. They lent to workers who couldn't in a month of Sundays pay that back. They didn't have the income, they didn't have the prospects for higher income, they were borrowing money that it just was not in the cards they would be able to pay back. And a bank that overlent to workers, or here's the European dilemma these days. A bank that lent to a government who can't pay it back. All due respect. Greece, for example, at least that's the talk in Europe. There's a risk that the Greek government, with a debt that is too high, will, either because it can't have any other option or it's fearful of its own political survival, will declare a default. By the way, do governments do that? You betcha. 5 years ago, the government of Argentina defaulted on its debt, cut it in half. Hundreds of billions are gone. It's just that we're not paying that. By the way, Argentina is doing better now than it has for 10 years. So the notion, if you default, it's the end of the world, is wrong. And the Greeks understand this perfectly. So a bank may have discovered that it overlent to workers, America, and it may have overlent to governments. And then it faces non-repayment, and then it may be unable to lend to anybody. And that would include businesses. So if you want to know how a financial crisis, a problem of banks unable to get payback on all the loans they've made, could destroy the whole economy, that's where we are in the United States. The crisis begins here, but it has crippled the borrowing capacity of corporations who are therefore cutting back. And of course, as they cut back because they can't get credit, they lay off workers. If they lay off workers, there's less goods being purchased, which gives them another reason to lay off workers. And that's why we went from 7 million unemployed in December of 2007 to 15.5 million unemployed in the United States now in the summer of 2007. Both. They are both short of money. The crisis starts when they have no more money. And they have no more money because nobody's paying them back. Or at least a large enough number of individuals and businesses cannot repay that they have no money to lend. So they're in terrible trouble. They, by the way, when that happened, and that happened in the summer of 2008, starting late 2007 into 2008, the bank suddenly said to the United States government, here in the United States, we are not getting repaid, there is a default, the subprime homeowner isn't paying his or her mortgage payments, the businesses that are falling apart because housing is collapsing, they're not going to be able to pay, we can see no money coming back, we're not in a position to lend, so we're going to stop lending to the businesses of the United States, in which case the economy collapses. They went to George Bush, and then they went to President Obama, and they said, either you bail us out, you get the credit system going again, or the whole economy is going to come to a crashing halt. That's exactly what happened. And Mr. Geithner, the current Secretary of the Treasury, and the others, had hurried meetings night after night in New York and Washington. We have to bail out the banks so that they can resume lending, or else it's all over. I mean, it's all over. One of the reasons we rushed in with trillions, with a T, to bail out the banking system was what you now understand. Without those banks able to lend at least to the major corporations, we're done. our system stops. And we don't have 15 million unemployed, we have 50 million unemployed. And then, Lord help us as a nation. So that was the crisis. So the government came in and bailed them out. But your question is very good. Those banks took the money that the government gave them, lent them, invested in them. And then the government said, of course, you know, the whole idea is we're giving you the money, please lend it out. The banks went to the government, it was all 2008, 2009, went to the government and said, you must be crazy. Lending the money out is what got us into this mess. You're bailing us out. That's our job, is to hold on to the money and not lend it to the people who can't pay. So what the banks did is they took the money the government bailed out and they held on to it, which is the logic of what a banker should do in this kind of a situation. But it made everybody angry. Gee, the banks aren't lending it out. Hello, that's how they got into the problem. Of course they're not gonna lend it out. The government bailed them out and they held on to a lot of it because it's too dangerous. Can't lend to the workers, they're already defaulted. You don't wanna lend to government, which by the way, is a major thing they've been doing, lending the government. Because the government's had to borrow to bail them out. Let's do that again. The banks lent to the government the money that the government used to bail out the banks. If you understand that, and you understand that you're not a bank, that's why they're doing well, and you're not. Okay? That's the way this system works. That's the efficiency and the prosperity that capitalism delivers to the people who live in it. So the banks are now sitting on a lot of money that they are lending only to a few governments, like the United States, that they think are secure. They don't even want to lend it to half of the countries in Europe if it's not secure anymore. They sure as hell are not going to lend it to workers. Across America, people are being informed by their bank, your credit limit on your credit card is being reduced, your credit card is being taken back, your credit limits, all of that's happening across the board. People are all upset, they didn't do anything wrong. They get a letter from their bank saying your credit is reduced. Yeah, welcome. The banks are taking care of their business, as they are supposed to do. But what I want you to see and what Marxian was saying is, the idea that the relationship between finance capital and industrial capital is a study in the efficiency. This is a chaotic system. It is not under control. It is not beautifully oiled and working like a well-functioning machine. No, it isn't. It's dependent on all of these decisions made by these independent decision makers. Sometimes they can all work out together. That's true, sometimes they can. And sometimes they work at cross purposes, like now. But there's no built-in mechanism that manages this in a coherent way. And that's how we got a financial crisis in the first place, and one that then became a crisis of the so-called real economy of employment as the second step, and we're still in that. The banks have recouped a good bit of the losses because of the government bailout and holding on to their money. That has helped the banks and the stock market where the banks play to come back a good bit. But it has meant that the employment situation of the country has deteriorated virtually straight line.
If the fundamental idea was to pool savings, lend it out at an interest rate and the difference between what you recover, where you make your money. Workers no longer save. Capitalists no longer borrow. Is it all just all offset by fees and people's equity in their homes have been halved? Where is all the savings of this negative savings?
Savings in the end, remember that when economists use the word savings, they refer not just to the savings of workers and individuals, but also to the savings of corporations. Every part of what a corporation takes in that it doesn't immediately spend, it puts in the bank. That's considered economically as a saving. It is now in the bank's hands, and the bank doesn't want to sit on that money. It wants to lend that out. So likewise with persons, the net saving per year of the American working class is zero. Americans don't. But during the year, you put money in the bank that sits there for a week, a month, half a year before you draw it out. That money, the minute it is placed in the bank, is considered savings, because savings is just what you do with money other than immediately spent. So all of that money is collected by banks and made available to whoever they can lend it to. By the way, critics of this have always existed. People have said, I don't mean Marxists now, just all kinds of other people. Savings is a collective quantity, right? What a bank does is take lots of money from lots of different people. It is, in a sense, the discretionary fund that the mass of the population doesn't need right now to buy things with. It's put in the bank. Why should the bank, a profit-making institution, have it in its power to decide whether or not to lend that to somebody? That's a social accumulation, and it should be allocated based on the needs of the society without the intermediation of a bank trying to make profit. It's a classic argument for the social dimension of economics that should not be allowed to be under the control of a private entity seeking to make money for itself, and in the process deciding what to do with the society's savings that the society needs to have available to it.
Yeah. So with the time value of money theory that's going on, also in this, when you loan, right, the money up front is worth more later, so you have to keep raising the interest to make up for that. And as the interest rises, so does the calculation for the value of that money today. So doesn't that eventually just keep rising until it bottlenecks itself?
No, because you got to be careful. The notion that a dollar today is worth more than a dollar next month, that isn't true. Or rather, it's only true under particular circumstances. Let me give an example when it isn't true. Suppose you either have already or you believe you're about to face something called a deflation, a period of time when prices are going down. We've had that in our history. And there are many people, by the way, who think that that over the next year or two is going to be what we have here. If you believe that a deflation is what's coming, or already underway, then a dollar today is worth less than a dollar tomorrow. Why? Because the dollar today will buy less than it will tomorrow, because the prices will be lower tomorrow than they are today. So under those circumstances, you don't need a premium, an interest payment, to lend money. You'd be perfectly happy to lend someone money and they pay you back, maybe even less than you lent them. You'd still be ahead if the prices were lower a year or two from now. So the whole notion of what an interest rate is in terms of time depends on the social condition. The time alone tells you nothing.
But isn't the inflationary period basically...
The reverse.
Yeah, it drags you down into a recessionary period. That's like almost like it's perpetuated that chaotic cycle of capitalism where eventually it's going to bottleneck itself.
Okay, I misunderstood. Yes, these are self-reinforcing. Think of it in my example a minute ago. If you think prices are going to fall, you don't spend now. You hold back. But if anything is going to make merchants drop their prices even more, it's everybody holding back, expecting prices to fall. So your very expectation becomes a factor bringing to pass what you expect. And with inflation, it's the same thing. If you think prices are going to be higher next year than now, buy the TV now, not tomorrow. But if everybody does that, the price of TVs will go up even faster. So yes, in our crazy system, where everything is efficient and all worked out, we live in a world in which our fears of what may happen often lead us to take steps that make the likelihood of what we fear all the greater. And if that strikes you as an irrational system, good. Understood.
Yeah. Of course, there's another source of capital that potentially circumvents the banks entirely. That is, if the company issues stocks, bonds directly to the public.
Right. If I had time, I would go through all that.
Right.
Banks are not the only way that a capitalist can get money. That's right. A bank can issue stocks, new shares of stock that people buy. That's a source of money. The corporation can also lower wages and get more surplus and try to be self-financing, requiring neither bank borrowing nor share issuance, and so on. So, you know, if I had a full spectrum at the time, I'd go through all of that. But what I've shown you still helps you, I hope, to understand, as Marxian theory does, how a crisis would have arisen in finance and how it would affect the rest of the economy. And that's the history of the United States in the last 3 years. The banks basically took advantage of a social situation, the end of rising wages, moved into that consumer lending on a massive scale for 30 years, wildly overdid it. I'm not even telling you about all the complicated lending to one another that was built on top of lending to workers. This is what you've heard about credit default swaps, these very new kinds of gimmicks in which banks borrowed and hustled from each other to get in on the money to be made by lending to workers and so on. This spun out of control, went way beyond what was sustainable. That then collapsed. That put the banks in a drastic mess, and they proceeded to squeeze the other capitalists. And everybody squeezed the workers by firing them in large numbers. And so the system is trying to right itself, and everybody is trying to screw everybody else rather than be screwed. But this doesn't sound like a well-oiled machine. This should sound to you like the Hobbesian universe of everybody against everybody, and see who comes out at the end. The banks are very pleased. They got the money from the government. They got it first, which turned out to be real smart, because nobody asked any questions in 2008. They just poured money on the banks. Now, when we want to extend unemployment benefits to unemployed workers who've been unemployed for more than 6 months, it's a drawn-out, multi-month debate over an amount of money that is nothing compared to what was given to the banks a year and a half ago. What's going on? That's the old story. It's better be the first one to borrow than to be the nth one. By the time N comes along, everybody's worried about what's left to be lent out, and you get the short end of the stick. The banks are very pleased. They ended up being the major cause of the crisis and the major beneficiary of the anti-crisis program. Very nice for them. Yeah.
Was there an alternative to bailing out the banks that would have restarted the whole credit system, or, you know?
Very good question. And if this were a course on the crisis, I would give you the long answer. Let me give you the short answer. Assuming the capitalist system, your question is right on. No. If you're going to get the credit system going again, and if the central agency for credit is the banking system, with an assist, for example, by insurance companies, because the insurance business had insured all of these crazy loans of people to one another. That's what AIG was about. In our system, if you're going to have private enterprises in the credit business and you want to get credit going, you have to bail them out. Absolutely right. What would be an alternative? Well, here's an alternative. You nationalize all the banks. It's the end of private banking. You basically declare credit is too important for the functioning of our economic system to be in the hands of private bankers who have proved to us that they are not trustworthy guardians of the enormous economic power they have as concentrated bankers. That's the end of a private credit system. You socialize the banking sector. By the way, European countries, France is a good example, did this. After World War II, basically, French banks were nationalized. And so for many years, the French banking system was owned and operated by the government. And the government decided what happens with the money that's deposited in banks. Individuals and companies deposit in the bank, but it's a government bank. And the government allocated the credit and didn't use profit as the calculation and the standard by which to allocate it. It was the social benefit of distributing credit. And so they supported, for example, they wanted to build up their wine production, because they're famous in the world for that. So wine producers had access to credit on preferred terms, et cetera, et cetera. So that would be an alternative way.
What about the possibility of giving the money to the people that lost their money in the houses that would then put that money in the bank rather than...
Well, that's not an alternative. What that would have done is it would have reduced the crisis in the banks. For example, if you had, I assume you're going in this direction, if you had responded to the crisis by a massive government program of hiring, so the federal government came in and said, okay, we have 15 million people without a job. We're not going to give them unemployment benefits. We're going to give them a job. We're going to hire them, pay them a proper salary, and have them do useful things. Well, what that would have meant is millions of workers who were defaulting on their credit cards wouldn't have, who were defaulting on their mortgage payments wouldn't have, because they would have had the job, earning the income that would allow them. So it would have been a way to seriously reduce the crisis that was afflicting them by enabling these people to continue payments. The problem was that by the time the crisis hit, millions of workers were so deep in debt that even with a regular job at a reasonable salary, they couldn't sustain themselves. And so you would have had to at least mix such kind of a mass program with still a major reorganization of finance to cope with this crisis. Yeah. Yeah.
term that are, you know, agency or union, of course, that our establishment is going to be okay with permanent 10% unemployment and not lending to lots of people, including small businesses. What do you think?
Yes, I think that's definitely part of what's unfolding. I think, I mean, to make a long, again, story short, I think between the movement of jobs out of the United States to other parts of the world where wages are much lower and taxes are lower and environmental demands are lower and so on, you're creating a situation here in the United States in which we're not going to have work for millions of people. This, by the way, is a shock perhaps for the American people, but for most people around the world, it's their normal condition. What it means is that the United States is going to look more and more like the rest of the world. It's going to have a core of very rich people, very comfortable, in all the Manhattan and the nice parts of Chicago. You know where all the nice parts are. And a hinterland of people in deep trouble, barely getting by, falling further and further behind culturally, educationally, from the core. And that is the norm in the world. And the United States is in a very delicate moment now, because the fear of those who run the society is the question. Will a population that has been exempted from all of that for 150 years, that lives in the exceptional United States, the very wealthy, will they tolerate it? Can you impose those conditions on a population that thought it was immune from that problem? That, if you want my own opinion, that's the number one political question of the rest of our lives, how that will be managed and how the American people will react.
Yeah. So if the problem in the real economy at this point is that the banks are holding on to their money, my question is, the banks only make money by lending it. So presumably they're holding on to it because they expect they can lend it at a higher interest rate later.
That's right.
But they each, you know, too big to fail was the main slogan. So they must, each bank individually must know that if they are holding on to credit, they have enough sway that it might never boost up the real economy again. And why then would they expect that they could get a higher interest rate?
Because they have no choice. It's not that they want this. They don't have secure, profitable outlets for lending. One of the reasons the United States is able to borrow apparently unlimited sums to do all this bailing out is because American banks and other countries' banks will lend to the United States at historically very low interest rates because it's the best they can do. They're not happy about it, but it's the best they can do. One of the reasons, if you haven't noticed it already, but you will, that everything you do with the bank is going to have a fee attached to it. Kiss the no check, no fee checking goodbye. Kiss all. You're going to, you notice over recent years, if you bounce a check, the fees get higher and higher. The banks are having to try to recoup their income because they're not making the kind of money lending. The government would like to accommodate them and let interest rates rise. But if interest rates rise, nobody's going to buy a house. No one's going to buy a car, and that's too dangerous, so they can't do that. So the government has to keep the interest rates low, so the banks are not making enough money, and you have this endless pushing and shoving to get around this situation. But they are holding back because of their concerns that they don't have safe places, or they're lending particularly to governments because they're secure, but that makes their profits so low that they have to. And by the way, one of the things they're beginning to do is play the stock market again, to recoup the rate of return that they need because they can't make money lending. So they become lenders to people who play the stock. One of the reasons the stock market has done well is that the banks have been pouring money into the stock market to make the money they can't make in any of these other ways. But folks, we're going to kill the next topic if I don't. I understand your interest. I promise you, what we're about to do with the household will be at least as interesting.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, let's turn then to the household and class analysis using Marxian theory from Capital to analyze the household. I have to begin, of course, by demystifying or perhaps removing the very shock that some of you may have in your minds at the thought of a Marxist analysis of the household. I'm going to show you how class exists inside the household, how class struggle of all kinds exists inside the household. That's a bit of a shock, because we live in a society which doesn't recognize that class exists in the household, that class struggles occur there. Class, in other words, has been invisible in that place in society where we all live, the household. But that shouldn't really bother you, because for most people, class is invisible in the factory too. Class is invisible at the office or in the store. The whole problem, one of the goals of Marxism, is to teach you, the person to whom Marxism is presented, to understand the relevance, the existence of class and class processes and class conflict in all the places where conventional ideology says it isn't there. If you talk to a professor of economics in the United States today and ask him where's the class struggle in the enterprise, they look at you blankly. Nothing in their education has taught them how to answer such a question. It sounds to them like a nonsensical question. It's not that they would try to answer you, they would impugn the absurdity of this question. So the same thing is perhaps in your mind about the household, but it's the same question. It's the same question. The class processes, and hence the Marxian apparatus to understand class, to analyze an economy by looking at the production distribution of surplus, you can do the same thing in a household. Now, it's true that whereas Marxists for the last 150 years have done this kind of analysis of enterprises, it is true they have not done it for households. So that the Marxian tradition is itself partly responsible for the invisibility of class analytics in the household. It contributed to that, not consciously, perhaps not intentionally, but it did. And that's because Marxism is not immune to the impact of the larger society, never was. In modern bourgeois culture, the household is considered out of the economic system. It isn't analyzed 99% of the time in any economics. Indeed, it was only the women's liberation movement that developed in the United States in the 1960s and 70s that finally forced the economics profession to begin to seriously deal with the household as an object of economic analysis. And then not just Marxists, but non-Marxists did it as well. By the way, very conservative economists had analyzed how a household works. One of the closest colleagues of Milton Friedman at the University of Chicago, a professor named Gary Becker, B-E-C-K-E-R, became a specialist in applying conventional neoclassical economics to the household. Famous for an article in which he analyzes why people get married by looking, the man has a desire for his consumption of goods and services from the wife, and his attitude towards the desirability of children. And the wife has one, and they get married if these two are compatible. It's a little bit like I go to the store and I buy Rice Krispies instead of bananas, because I like Rice Krispies better than bananas. So I like marriage rather than not marriage, and I like Marianne rather than Louise. But it's a calculation of the utility of doing this, which, if you know conventional economics, is how they reason. And Becker does that. But I want you, in the time before we take a little break, I want you to go with me into the relationships inside the household and ask the same question that Marxian theory asks outside the household. Here are the questions. Is there labor going on? Are people using their brains and muscles to transform raw materials into finished products? Because that's what goes on in an enterprise. Remember the chair example? People are using raw materials, wood, using their brains, concept of a chair, and their muscles to transform the wood, the glue, the nails, and the hammer into a chair. Is something comparable happening inside the household? Second question. If labor is going on in the household, is there a surplus being produced? Is there somebody who's producing more than they themselves consume and delivering it to somebody else, in the way that a worker in a capitalist enterprise produces more, the surplus, than he or she gets for working there? Or in the language from before, value added is larger than the value paid to them. In the household, is a surplus being produced? And if so, by whom? And who gets it? Those questions have to be asked, because the household is a place in society, just like the enterprise is a place in society. So let's ask the questions that Marxian theory implies, and you'll see right away what the results are. Is labor performed there? Of course it is. Raw carrots are processed by means of labor into a meal. A dirty shirt is transformed into a clean and ironed one. Brains and muscles are transforming raw material by means of tools and equipment into a different finished product. A clean shirt is different from a dirty one. A cooked meal is different from raw carrots. A broken piece of furniture is repaired. You understand this, by the way, because you all know in our society that regular enterprises do all that too. The same labor goes on in an enterprise that I just described at a home. We live in a time when more and more of what used to be done at home is now done in an enterprise. Everybody used to cook at home. Now many people buy prepared food, etc. So the household is a place where labor is performed. Physical labor, just like in an enterprise. But to pique your interest, I want to talk just for a moment about another kind of labor that is particularly present in the household. It's present elsewhere too, but it's part of a new development within Marxian theory that is worth your while and is taken up in this book, which is one of those books I mentioned to you, Class Struggle on the Home Front, Work Conflict and Exploitation in the Household, a book put out this year, a collection of essays using the Marxian analysis I'm teaching you now on a whole range of topics having to do with household. If you're interested, this is the place to pursue it. Okay, labor in the household, physical labor, we finished. Here's another kind, emotional labor. This is different. This is using your brains and muscles not to produce a good or a service outcome, but something a little harder to define. It's using your brains and muscles to change the feelings of another person, or indeed yourself. It's an attempt to alter the emotional state of another person. It's what a spouse does when his or her other half comes home from work, exhausted, aggravated, upset, irritated, and tries to adjust those feelings, calm them down, reassure them, comfort them. That's an enormous effort. It takes brains and muscles to do that, and that's a whole other kind of labor, and we're going to talk about that at the end of our discussion of the house. But to keep things simple and to make the story persuasive, I'm going to stay with physical labor, cooking, cleaning, shopping, childcare, repairing furniture, curing people's medical problems, all the labor that is done inside the household. So we've established that there's labor going on, just as there is in enterprises. Next question. Is there somebody producing surplus for somebody else in the course of the labor, which is what we've seen in an enterprise? Well, let's see. I'm going to take as my example the, quote, traditional household in the United States. I'm very aware that not all households look like this. I'm doing a stylized version. You can adjust it for all the other kinds of households. But in my stylized traditional household, here's what we got. An adult male, the husband, who goes out to work 9 to 5, 5 days a week, and then comes home. The wife, who stays at home. She is a housewife, a homemaker, whatever words you want. She does the cooking and the cleaning and all of that in the home. Now let's look. First, the husband's out of the picture. He doesn't do labor in the household. He does labor at the enterprise. The wife does labor in the household. Let's see what she does. For example, when she makes the bed, she transforms the raw material, a rumpled bed, into a nicely made bed. Does she just produce a made bed on her side of the double bed? No. She makes that part nice, she makes the other part nice too. She makes the whole bed. Number two, when she prepares dinner, Is it dinner for one? No. It's dinner for herself and the husband when he comes home. When she cleans, does she clean only the part of the apartment she steps on, the rug in, or do you get the picture? There is surplus done. Somebody who's doing labor is producing more output than they themselves get. Just like a worker in an enterprise adds more value when he or she works than is paid back to them in a wage. So it turns out, and all of this is done in great detail in the book if you're interested, that the whole household in the United States is a site of labor and a site of class, that is, the production of surplus. And in the story I just told you, we can now answer, who produces the surplus? Answer, the wife. And who gets the surplus? The husband. Uh-oh. Let's do that again. The household has inside of it a class structure. The production of surplus by one member of the household and its appropriation by another. This is not like the capitalist enterprise because, for example, there's no wage payment. The husband doesn't shell out money for the wife each day the way an employer has to do for a worker. It's also not in value terms. There's no delivery of money or cash or anything like that from the wife to the husband. Her surplus takes the form of the delivery of product in the example I gave you. And now it's really interesting. Notice what else is different. There's no profit calculator. The employer has to make money. The husband is not making money out of anything. The husband is happy with the delivery of the surplus by the wife. It's what he expects. It's what she expects. Indeed, when they got together to make a household, they each swore to love, honor, and cherish or obey one another, which the husband understood to mean, you're at home and you make my side of the bed too. And she understood as an expression of love that she would perform those functions. So it's really interesting. You have a class structure, but it's not held together by a market. There is no market. By wage payments, there are none. By profit calculations, there are none. What is holding it together? We know why the worker comes to work and produces surplus for the employer, because he gets a salary and a wage for that, and that's how he lives. So we understand. What is it with the wife? Well, what holds her there is a conception of her place in the world. She's held together by a ritual on top of a conception, right? She thinks of herself as a person who will be married and do this, perhaps replicating what her mother was a model for. She goes through a ritual of committing herself. She uses words like love, and cherish, and honor. But in class terms, she is entering into a relationship with a man that entails producing a surplus for him. Although, when we handle this, just let me finish the basic point, then I'll answer the question, then we'll take our brief break. The way we handle this is to say that there is a class process and structure going on here, class process, the production and appropriation of surplus. I'm going to show you after the little break how the surplus gets distributed, just like the capitalist does. But for this, for the moment, class goes on in the household. In my traditional household, the surplus producer is the female. The surplus appropriator is the male. Of course, households could be reversed. We could have the man doing the surplus and the woman. The gender is a separate matter from the class structure. But the traditional household clearly puts women in that position of surplus producer. It isn't capitalist. No wages, no profit, no prices, no none. So what is it? Well, it's a different class structure. Still got the surplus, It's not capitalist. It's not slave. The man can't buy and sell all life. It's not self-employed because there's two people, not one person. What is it? And the answer is, it's feudal. And this is one of the most interesting implications of this analysis. Households are a kind of feudal class problem. What do I mean? Well, the word feudal comes from medieval Europe. It has to do with the Middle Ages, roughly 500 AD to around 1600 AD. 1100 years that Europe was in a feudal class structure. What was a feudal class structure? It had two players, not the employer-employee, because feudalism didn't have that. There were no wages. There were no proletariat. In many parts of feudal Europe, there was no price and no market. What bound the two players of feudalism together, and they had names. One was called a serf, and the other was called a lord. The serfs, typical of feudalism, worked Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday on the land allocated to them. Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, the serf left the land that he farmed with his family and went to work on the land of the lord. And whatever the serf produced the first 3 days, he kept for himself. And whatever the serf produced the last 3 days on the land of the lord belonged to the lord. So the fruit of the last 3 days was the surplus, was what the worker, the serf, produced that he himself didn't get. That was delivered to the other. What held the two together? A conception, a ceremony, and a ritual. You've seen it in the movies. The serf gets down on one knee, and the lord comes over and taps him on the shoulder with the flat of the sword, and the serf looks up appealingly into the face of the lord and promises, it's from the Middle Ages, to love, honor, and cherish him. And the lord promises the same to the serf. Both of them understand what it means. The serf will produce a surplus for the lord, and the lord will gratefully receive it. 1100 years people live with that. So one of the first implications of Marxian theory is that it has identified labor in the household, it has identified class, and it's given the class a name. That we have a class structure in the household which is different from the one outside. Meaning that the American people, for example, the American proletariat, start playing with this now, folks. It's a powerful apparatus here. It means the following kinds of things. That an American worker lives, he or she, in one class structure at home, and a different one at work. And that's a problem to navigate back and forth in the same day between different class structures and different ways of identifying who you are. Think of the next idea. The man, in general, goes out to work at a place where he produces surplus for the employer. That's, after all, why he's employed. But at home, the man occupies a very different class position. He's not the producer of the surplus, he's the appropriator of somebody else's, which means the man has a conflicted relationship to class. He's on both sides in his two different locations, which might mean that he's conflicted about his ideology, his politics, and what he does. If a woman adds to her household position as a surplus producer a job in the larger society where she's also a surplus producer, then the wife in a modern capitalist society is exploited twice, once on the job, and again at home. The husband isn't. And that may mean a different attitude between men and women to the whole apparatus of class analysis and class struggle. Wow. Let me boast. No other theoretical apparatus to analyze households has ever come up with anything like this. You either use Marxian theory to figure this out, well, you don't have anything. Here's a thought. You could teach the American people, as part of everybody's education, to understand the class structure of the household, just like you would teach them to understand the class structure of enterprise, in which case everybody would have to confront, what does this mean? Do I want to be a household serf? Do I want to be a household lord? Or, as the American slogan has, each man is a king in his castle. What an interesting metaphor. How very, very appropriate, given the feudalism of our class-structured households. But it might also begin to be possible for people to ask the following question. If the ideology of marriage has to do with love, affection, nurturance, equality, and mutual support, how in the world will a marriage survive if it has to coexist, this ideology, with an underlying class reality in which one person is exploiting the other? Isn't it likely that the class conflict embedded in that relationship will erode and undermine whatever affect brought the couple together? That would be a Marxist question about the difficulty in modern society of partnering, of relationships, particularly in a society where the difficulty of household class production is intense. Okay, two quick questions, then we need to take a break and come back and do this again. Yes, ma'am, can I
show you? There's another way to look at the appropriation of this. I agree that there's an appropriation of surplus value,
right.
But capitalists that employ the husband pays him a wage in order to reproduce his labor. Mm-hmm. And instead of having to pay for the husband to get fed and somebody to prepare his meals and so on and make his bed, the fact that he has a wife doing it means that he doesn't have to pay that into his wage. So the appropriation of the surplus value that's created is actually being appropriated by the capitalist, by the boss of the husband.
Okay. Half. I agree with you, half. Let me show you how I would handle this, and this is done in the book as well. A household's budget. It turns out to be a very complicated thing once you do Marxian theory. Let's deal with the husband first. The husband gets a wage. Let's assume he goes out to work, he gets a wage. But he also gets the surplus labor of his wife. Okay? So in a sense, the husband gets the income from selling his labor power in the larger power world, and then he gets the surplus produced by his wife. This one is in money. This one is not in money, this is in product, goods and services, okay? But, careful now, our husband also has complicated expenses. As in Marxian theory, as the question says, he uses, we assume, the money from his job to reproduce his capacity to labor. He buys his clothing and his shoes and his car and all the rest of the crap that he needs to be able to keep earning. He has to reproduce himself. And he has the benefit of the wife, the surplus that she delivers to him. Now let's look at the possibilities, because that's what a good apparatus of theory allows you to do, explore the reality. Here's one possibility. Our husband has a ball. He appropriates the surplus his wife does, which saves him from having, she makes a meal for him, so he doesn't have to go out and buy one. She cleans his clothes, so he doesn't have to go out and take it to the cleaner and all of this. So he has extra wages to have a good time. What is saved, in a sense, by his wife working. Is that a possibility?
Sure it is.
Does that happen?
Oh, no.
There's another possibility. Our husband has to provide the wife with the tools and equipment and the premises in which to do surplus labor. So he takes a part of his wage and buys a stove, a fridge, a house, etc. He provides, like a capitalist does, the conditions for her to produce the surplus. So in a sense, he diminishes how much of his wage he can use for his own consumption to create the framework to appropriate the surplus from his wife. He may then understand that situation as being, hey, sweetie pie, I buy all the things here that you count on, because you use the fridge, and you use the stove, and you use the clothes dryer, and you live in a house. So this is sort of what you owe me. It's your giving to me, because in a sense, I'm giving to you. Does that happen? Is yet another way that this can be worked out. A husband can be so happy and satisfied with whatever surplus his wife brings him that he actually accepts a lower wage. The capitalist doesn't have to pay him as much as otherwise, because instead of having to require the capitalist to pay him so I can buy the things that reproduce my labor power, I'm cashing in on the surplus from my wife. In that case, the relationship inside the household carries a hidden subsidy to capitalism outside the household, because it allows the capitalist to get away with paying less to the husband than he otherwise would have to. These are all different ways in which the class relationships in the household impact the people who live there and the larger society. But the point here is, you have, before you can do any of this analysis, you have to see that there is class. Just like in Marxism, if you're going to do anything with organizing labor against capitalism, you have to begin by seeing and identifying the class processes going on in the enterprise. One quick question, let me take a brief break. Yeah?
It seems like you really prove that there is surplus value appropriate, and you have to look at all the ratios of, you know, all the things that the husband provides.
Yes.
So, I mean, in other words, in a simple situation where, let's say, the husband brings in the raw material and the wife cooks it in the traditional patriarchal setting, so the live labor that the woman performs, right, to cook the meal, let's assume that they divide the meal after it's cooked in half. In order to prove that there's surplus value appropriate for the husband, we have to prove that the live labor performed by the wife has more value than the value of the raw material that the husband brings. Otherwise, there is no surplus value appropriate by the husband, because they're dividing it by half, and those two parts, the live labor and the embodied labor of raw material.
There is no value. Value only exists when there's exchange. There is no exchange.
Labor.
This is all, that's right, it's all measured in terms of labor.
Labor.
The distinction is labor time, necessary labor time, and surplus.
Yeah.
How much of the labor you do produces an output that you yourself consume, and how much of your labor produces an output that somebody else gets? That's the issue. And you're right, and you see it in the book, if you do this analysis with this theoretical apparatus, you have to go into households and look exactly who's doing what. And remember, there's a whole range here. Let me tease you before we do the break. There's nothing that requires a household to be organized in this feudal way. Here's what's been going on in the United States in the last 25 years. The feudal household has been falling apart. It doesn't survive in our country anymore. It worked real well for 200 years. It's in terrible trouble now. The most rapidly growing kinds of household in the United States is the single adult household. People are not living with anybody. This was such a good time. This was so successful. That's the fastest growing one. Gay, heterosexual, both combined, that's where people are living. Alone, and it's led by the women. 3/4 of divorces are initiated by women in the United States. They can't stand it. That's the truth of it. And what happens? Well, one of the things that happens is the woman now with or without children, lives by herself. Husband likewise. But here's an interesting alternative. That ideology of love and affection and solidarity can take the form of a household, two or more people, in which none of this class process that we're used to, this exploitation somebody produces for somebody else, that's not allowed. Instead, the household works as follows. I think how many of you at least fantasize what I'm about to say. Husband and wife will do all work equally split. They will share the cooking, they will share the cleaning, they will share the childcare, and that's what's expected. And that's what they both assume. And together, they will both produce more than for just themselves. The husband will make the meals for both, and she'll clean, make the beds for both, whatever they do, division of labor. But they will both produce a surplus, and they will both decide how to distribute the surplus that they produce. Well, that would have to be called a class structure. Labor is going on, surpluses are being produced. But it's not feudal, and it's not capitalist, it's not slave, it's not a single person. Bingo. It's called communism. The communal, collective labor, collective production of surplus, and a collective distribution. Here's the thought then. In the United States of the last 30 years, there has been a revolutionary class transformation, but not where the politicos thought it was, not where the Marxists didn't look. It didn't happen at the enterprise. It did happen in the household, as millions of people voted with their feet and their painful divorces to walk away from a feudal class structure and try to create something else. A single household by yourself, a collective household with one person, or maybe a group of people. A collective household with all the problems. Wow. That would mean a class revolutionary transformation has been going on, and you didn't know, because you didn't look, because you didn't have the theoretical framework to even ask. And if you don't have the right theory, you don't see it. And what would that mean for political strategy? It might mean that it's as important for a leftist or a socialist or a radical to think about the processes of a house and organizing people in and around households as every bit as important, and in certain periods maybe more important, than working at the enterprise if the situation there isn't revolutionary, isn't falling apart, isn't being questioned. The serfs in the households of America have been questioned, particularly the women. That's what women's liberation was about. That's what the continuing struggle of women to change slowly and painfully the conditions into which they thought they had to fit. What I want to do now is to develop what we've done. We've really only talked about how inside the household there is necessary labor in a stylized household done by the wife slash serf, and a surplus that she produces that is appropriated by the husband. And it opens up an enormous range of questions and analyses which are in the book, and if we had a lot of time, I've taught whole semesters on nothing but the Marxian analysis of the household. I've done that very easy to do, and we don't have enough time there either. But I want to sketch for you what else becomes understanding. In a household, the husband, like the capitalist we saw in the enterprise, no sooner gets the surplus than the husband discovers that he has to distribute that surplus to reproduce the conditions of being a surplus-appropriating husband in the household. Just as we saw the capitalist, the industrial capitalist, had to distribute to the managers, to the government, to the banks, and so on. Well, how does that work in a household? Let's see. There has to be a distribution of the surplus to reinforce the wife's willingness, acceptance of her situation. The wife is, after all, a surplus producer for somebody else. In the Marxian language, she is exploited because she produces a surplus that somebody else gets. And there is always, in all systems of exploitation, a risk that the exploited person doesn't want to be exploited anymore. How is this handled both traditionally and now? The answer is, it's very important to convince, persuade, influence the wife to see her situation as a surplus producer as inevitable, as appropriate, as unchangeable, or all kinds of combinations. But that takes work. Somebody has to keep persuading her. Enter the church. The job of the church is to articulate an imagery that it is the appropriate, God-given, biologically designed, however you want to do this, that the woman be in that position. And a church has to be a place you go to where you hear this stuff. That has to be built. There has to be a person preaching this stuff. There has to be a person who comes to the house and reinforces it. There has to be, in short, an apparatus of people and means of production to produce the ideology that will make a surplus producer accept his or her position. In traditional households, churches were sustained by a surplus in a very tangible way. But some of you don't know this history. It used to be in many places in the world that the priest or the minister or the rabbi went around every night and had dinner in the home of a different one of his parishioners. Hospitality, dinner, overnight if he needed. That was literally the wife now produced a surplus, part of which went to her husband, and part of which the husband directed her to deliver in the form of a meal, a made bed, whatever. Modern form. The women of a community become the ladies' auxiliary of the local church. They bake pies on their own time, which they deliver, and they have a bake sale in the basement of the church, the proceeds of which sustain the church. In other words, a portion of her surplus labor is directed by the husband to the benefit of the church. He does without that portion of her labor to sustain an institution that sustains her in the position. It explains to her that that's what a woman's role ought to be. Footnote. One of the largest church denominations in the United States is called the Southern Baptist Federation or
Convention.
And they have a very interesting list of the proper role of women. That's it. A Marxist probably wrote it because it fits so perfect. So get that. Just Google it, you'll find it. It's a, what the woman is, the man is the head of the household, man is in the house, is God in the community, etc. Okay, so that's one. Here's another thing, the household. It has to pay taxes. The way our country works, the maintenance of your household, the clean street in front of it, the fire department that comes and puts out a fire that allows you to continue to exploit your wife in the house because it would be hard to do if they were all burnt down. Those come out of the household. The house, all local communities attach taxes to households. That's how it works. So that has to come up. Now notice, this is usually demanded in money. Uh-oh, she doesn't produce money. By the way, could a wife produce a surplus in money? Sure. Instead of making extra bed or extra time fixing the furniture, the husband can direct the wife to make crafts and go into town and sell them. Then she would earn money, which she turns over to the husband. Then the surplus she does would take a money form. Does that happen? Absolutely. In many societies, a lot of that. But we're going to assume that the money has to be paid in taxes, but she's working in the household. So now the husband, remember before, has to take a part of his wages to pay the tax. And he can't spend it on himself. He has to pay a tax for the household. It's like buying a fridge or a stove. And so he sees her surplus delivered to him as her share, compensating him for paying the taxes out of his wages. The complexity of a household budget that has to encompass the man in the outer tax class structure of the enterprise and the internal class structure of the household. And we're not done. It's now more complicated. There has to be management. Remember how we saw in the factory, a part of the surplus has to be paid to the managers. We went through that last time. Well, the household has to be managed. Records have to be kept. Equipment has to be purchased to maintain the household, all kinds of stuff. So who's going to do that? You need to buy a ledger, you need to have a pen, you have to have a desk where this is done, and someone has to do it. Often it's the wife. A part of her surplus is, in a sense, paid back to her. She is getting a cut of the surplus for being a manager as well as the producer of the surplus. You might call it a worker self-management arrangement inside the household. All of these are fascinating to pursue to understand the complexity that households can have even within a feudal class structure and the same parallel with any other kind of class structure. Next, just to show you some of the implications. The wife may find herself in a position, let's take the feudal traditional household, where the husband is not anymore able to bring home enough wages to secure the feudal household. He cannot pay for the fridge, the stove, all the other things. It doesn't work. And the family cannot continue, or at least it cannot work at the level it wants to. It cannot generate the cash income without which it can function. And so a decision is made that the wife, the other adult in the household, must replicate the husband. She, too, Monday to Friday, must go out of the house and work in the world of capitalism outside, get a job from an employer, and produce perhaps surplus for the employer. In other words, she's like the husband. And as someone correctly pointed out to me in the little break we had, this has certainly been part of the United States. At the end of World War II, or in the 50s and 60s, we had roughly 20, I believe it was the number, 20% of adult married women working outside the household. Today, the number is 80%. There is no more important social change in the United States over the last 40 years than that. That revolutionizes everything. That's very fundamental. So what I'm just about to analyze is a real situation. What happens then? What happens? Our wife, as I hinted at you before, is now in a peculiar situation. She is exploited twice. On the job, she produces surplus for the employer. At home, she produces surplus for the husband. And here are some hard statistics for you. Women did 85 to 90% of the housework in the 50s and 60s. They do 75% now. The women going out to work did not change, at least in the United States, the basic division of labor inside the household. So women did not fundamentally alter. They reduced it some, but not very much. And the result has been women in our culture, doubly exploited, have resorted to a whole set of mechanisms to cope with that burdensome situation. I'll give you just a few. One, American adult married women are the largest consumer of psychotropic drugs of any population in the world by a huge margin. Tranquilizers, uppers, downers, the whole apparatus, that is overwhelmingly a women's medication. Now, unless you believe.
Legal and legal?
What?
Is that legal and
legal? Well, there's no way to measure the illegal, so it's mainly the legal, but the assumption is, yeah.
Is there any difference between married and single women in that score?
There are statistics about that. I just don't have it in my head. I just have the ones about the matter. But the single women, much less than the men. Unless you believe that women are, for some reason, American women, unlike others, or women, unlike men, have some physical reason to be addicted the way they are, this is clearly, I would argue, a reflection of the situation they're in, which is unbearable. And so they turn for comfort to something that people turn for comfort to, in a culture where there are prohibitions and taboos about other kinds of self-comforting when you're under that kind of pressure. It also has something to do with the level of divorce. I mean, if you compare this situation to one in which you at least get rid of one exploiter, the husband, you can't afford to get rid of the, you have to have a job, but you can get rid of this other one, and so you do. I want to remind you, 3/4 of divorces are initiated by women. So it's a situation in which women have been under extraordinary pressures, and I think it shows up in difficulty of relationships, difficulty of marriages surviving. We do have the highest divorce rate in the advanced world. Problems between parents and children, a generation of alienation between parents and children, and a sense of distance between them, and all the other things that we talk about in our society, but which the Marxian argument would say have something to do. It's not the only part of the story, but part of the reason we have the social and cultural problems we do has to do with the extraordinary contradictions and tensions in the class structure of households. But in order to see it and evaluate it, you have to have a theory that at least recognizes that there is such a thing as a class structure of the household. And the Marxian theory that I've developed for you aims to do just that. Hold on a second. Let me introduce, just because it's so complicated and I don't have enough time. Children, right? Up until now, I've been talking about households minus something really interesting. The little ones, the next generation, the children. How do you begin to handle that in a household with a class structure? And let's stay with our traditional feudal one, surplus labor, necessary labor. And now, for reasons that you don't need me to explain to you, a child arrives in the life of this couple. They have a child. Okay, what? How do we deal with this? Problem number one, for several years, that child, if it's going to survive, which many don't, but if it's going to survive, there has to be a flow of product to that child. It has to be fed, clothed, housed, cleaned, and all of that, that takes labor. Where does it come from? Very interesting. Let's see. One possibility. The wife, does less labor for herself because her husband demands and gets the same flow of labor from her surplus. So if the child is going to survive, the wife has to consume less to free up part of what she used to produce and consume herself will now go to sustain the child. That's one option. Second option. The husband can say no, the husband and the wife together can say no, a part of the surplus that you, wife, used to produce for me, you are now going to produce and deliver to the child. That's another possibility. Notice something about these two possibilities. The arrival of the child, great blessed event, is now going to either squeeze the standard of consumption of mama or of papa. That's going to be a struggle. That the people involved in this struggle are not conscious of it is really not very interesting. It actually makes that struggle more difficult for both of them because they don't know what's going on, but they're getting on each other's nerves. Who is going to take care of the child, feed the child, pay for the formula, pay for the diapers, all the rest of it? So the child enters into a class structure that has no place for it and has no consciousness that it's got that problem. So the problem has to be addressed, or else the child dies. So the problem has to be addressed, and blindly the two grope their way into this all unconsciously, and therefore their irritations will be explained by each to themselves and others in other terms. You don't really love the child. You don't care for them. Whoa. Talk about a strain in a relationship. The arrival of a child, for those of you who don't know, is in all psychological studies that I'm aware of. My wife is a shrink. I ask her all about these things. Every study that she's ever shown me, the arrival of a child is an enormous extra strain on all relationships. which is not to say that it's not a welcome event, it's not a love child, it's just whatever else it is, it's an enormous strain on a relationship. And it often when the child, the decision is made to have a child, it is done with the hope of cementing a relationship that already has trouble, but the irony is it actually makes it worse. And that's not understood, and that makes it worse too that it isn't understood. But the child represents a very serious problem. As the child gets older, this problem can be reorganized and managed. And the way that has often been done, not so much today as in the past, is when the child gets to be a certain age, the child is put to work next to the mother. And it also does necessary and surplus labor. In a sense, it pays the father back in surplus later in its life for the allocation and the diminution of his surplus earlier in life. The notion of the child as an investment of the father. Okay? You put these things together, and I simply leave you with the question. How do you handle the emotional affective relationships, parents and children, children with one another, if they have to, in addition to negotiating growing up, being born, and all the other things of life, they have to navigate unconsciously the class structure into which they are born. Last, the child grows up. What does the child see? What does the child experience in the class structure of the household? Keep in mind that the first introduction to class for most people is in the house, not in the enterprise. You grow up in a house, you don't go to work. What you see is the class structure of the household, a subordinate and a superordinate, a producer and an appropriator of surplus. Ask yourself the fantastic question, do we in fact, by having a class-structured household, thereby train people to accept the normality of class everywhere else? If it's class at home, if it's a super and subordinate relationship, then that won't be so upsetting, so surprising, or unbearable outside the home when you're old enough to go and find out what's out there. And so there's a way in which the household trains. And yet it's contradictory, because the network inside the house, the class structure, is different from the one outside. Inside the household, the people who are producers and appropriators of surplus always talk about loving each other, or at least that's the language of the ideology. Outside the household, you may begin as a young person imagining, especially if you listen to the employer, that he really loves you too. But you quickly learn that he doesn't. And that is a major trauma for large numbers of workers. Think of the number of workers we will see on television in America now, say, befuddled in front of a TV camera. I worked for 40 years at this company, and they just laid me off. And how is it possible? What? You scratch your head. Don't you understand the system? The employer is not your mother. The employer is not your father. Those relationships you thought were wrapped up with class aren't. Well, that's because you come out of one class structure where everything is in terms of personal obligations, rituals, affirmations, love, honor, and cherish. And you go into another which doesn't have any of that. Very hard transition. Very difficult to navigate in a lifetime or in a day. All right, folks. Because I have to do the radio interview, here's what I promise. I know we are going on to the third topic on the reading list that you have. But just as today, I began and we spent a good half hour finishing what we had done last week in terms of finance and industrial capital, we will begin next Tuesday by doing some of the things and answering some of your questions about the household. So stay with that. Maybe make a note of them for yourselves. And that's where we'll begin.